good evening. Baruch Hashem, I just drove 10 hours to arrive here, straight, from the morning until now, directly from Canada to Queens, to here. Baruch Hashem. Yeah. Not to cancel these two lectures, here and the next one. And we had a wonderful Shabbaton, amazing Shabbaton. And it's maybe, I don't know, maybe more than 10 times I've been in Canada. It seems that every time gets better than the previous one. And many people are waking up, interested. I think I gave about 11 or 12 lectures there, almost 2 hours each, almost one after the other straight with very short breaks. And almost all of them were packed with people. Like they all are interested to hear. You know, it's amazing. Yeah. All the other speakers were amazed because that seminar was really intense. Like one after the other. Usually they give an hour, 2 hours break. This one was really one after the other. English, Hebrew, all, everything full, Baruch Hashem. It makes me happy. But the things that made me even more happy, I saw a 13-year-old boy over there. Only 2 weeks ago, he had bar mitzvah. What a tzaddik. Incredible. When you see things like this, you know, Am Yisrael has future. Serious. Mamash like 20-year-old tzaddik. They're reading, fluent, singing in a tefillah, praying with all his heart. Mamash like an adult. Already behave like a rabbi. Very, very serious, no jokes, none. Mamash like a man. And that's very good. Because when you look around, you see the level of the young kids today. You're not so amazed. But all of a sudden, you hear here and there a shining diamond. It's really cheering you up. Today I would like to talk about doing mitzvot with happiness. In general, about happiness. And also about the eternal work and the external work. The eternal and the external work of the human being. And what does it mean? Many people today, their avodat Hashem, the service when it comes to religion, is only external. Really not, it doesn't really come from inside. It's all from the outside. I don't want to say it's show off. I don't want to say it's they're making a show, it's pretending, because really they mean if a person's starting to keep mitzvot, he has good intention for sure. Otherwise, what is he wasting his time for? Besides rare cases that people keep mitzvot for personal gain, maybe because they want to get married and they don't have a choice. The girl set some rules. You want to marry me, you have to be Shomer Shabbos and eat kosher. And he really does it for her, not really for Hashem. Besides that, other than cases like this, which are kind of rare, most people who start keeping mitzvot, they have something in their heart. But we find that many of what they do is only from the outside. For instance, a Jew should never have a difference between what he does when he's alone in his house, in his room, or when he's in front of people. He should be righteous, indoor, outdoor, always the same in the highest level. Many people, when they're next to the audience, you know, for instance, you come to pray, you see important people over there, so now they're busy showing off, making all kinds of strange faces, you know, all kinds of things, pretending like the Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. But it's only from the outside. The Avodat Hashem doesn't come really from the inside. It's true that in the beginning, when you pretend, later it should come from the outside. It's mitoch shelo lishma, ba lishma. But if after 10 years that a person keep mitzvot, everything is from the outside, which means when he's in front of people, he's tzaddik, when he's alone, he doesn't care, then something is wrong. The behaving of the person from the outside is actually an opposite mirror of his inside. If he needs to make a lot of shows, that means the inside is completely empty. If he doesn't need to show off nothing, none of the shows that people do, then you know the inside is extremely great. I'm talking about pride. I'm talking about when he prays. I'm talking about the dress, what he wears. Depend where he goes. He goes to certain places, he dressed like a tzaddik. He goes with his friends to places not supposed to be. All of a sudden, he's half a goy. Then you see that his avodat Hashem is not full. It's not coming from inside. It's all according to what people's going to say, what people's going to think about him. You understand? And that's really not a perfect avodat Hashem. Of course, it's better than nothing. It's better than nothing. Better than to be mechalel Shabbat. There's no question. At least he keeps Shabbat. Lo leshem shamayim. Not for the sake of heaven. But it's a million times better than to be a wicked person. He's a pretender. He's pretending. In Judaism, there's no permission to imitate one another. Yes, you're allowed to admire holy people. You're allowed to be jealous with chachamim, with righteous and intelligent scholars in Torah, that they have a great level of learning Torah. That's true, no problem. That's kinat sofrim, tarbe chokma. When you're jealous with a big chacham, with a rabbi that knows a lot of Torah, it only elevates you. Since you're jealous with him, maybe you'll be 5% of him. If you're not jealous with him, you'll stay zero for the rest of your life in learning. So since you learn, you saw, you are amazed by people's wisdom, then you become one day wise also. So that's very good. Some people are jealous with money, so they kill themselves until they make money. What really made them the money? Their jealousy. But that's stupid. That's not a mitzvah to be jealous with someone who has money. So the competition between two cousins or two friends or two neighbors or who knows what makes each one of them kill himself to get more and more money and to save, to show off. That's very foolish competition. But when it comes to Torah, very good, it's blessed. The more you're jealous with chachamim, the better it is. However, sometimes jealousy leads you to make horrible sins, such as Lashon Hara. Oh, he's a great chacham, he's really a holy man. Don't get me wrong, but there's always a but in the end. But I don't like this and this and that. You came to compliment him, you ended up speaking Lashon Hara with a big chacham. You gotta be careful. This is the way the Yetzer Hara is. He brings you to do mitzvah, supposedly, but he already has a whole plan set. That you're gonna start with the good, and then eventually you're gonna start with the bad, and you won't stop with the bad. 2-3 good things, 30 bad things. Why? What do you think? He's gonna tell you, go and speak about Gdol Ador Lashon Hara right away? You won't go. First, he gets you to start with compliments, and the rest is history. And you lose everything. So, in Judaism, we are not allowed to imitate each other. We are allowed to imitate Hashem. Ma'u rachum, afata rachum. Hashem is merciful, you be merciful. Hashem, has wisdom more than anybody, so you learn from Hashem's wisdom. Hashem is generous, so you learn from his generosity, of course. But why would you like to imitate a human being? Can you tell me why would you like to imitate any human being? That's a very big mistake. You know why? Because every human being in this world, his creator put him for a reason. And every person, besides all of us being Jewish, and we have the general rules that we have to keep, modesty, Shabbat, kosher, you know, watch our mouth, watch things that we do. There's an eye who watch over us all the time, and everything is recorded. And eventually everything will be displayed. You cannot run away from the sins you make. No matter where you hide, God is recording you. And everyone who dies, right away everything starts up there in his court, in the court of heaven. You cannot run out of it. There's one person in Israel who was a big criminal. His name, Avi Hajani. Today is a very big rabbi. I don't know very big, but a big rabbi. And how he became a big rabbi, he was a real gangster. Gangster, guns, knives. In Pardes Katz in Israel, in some neighborhoods over there, it's like saying Chicago, Harlem, I don't know what. The worst neighborhoods of America. In Israel, you also have some neighborhoods like this. That's where he comes from. In gangs. And guess what? He lives by his father. He was a young man in his 20s. He comes home one night. Someone waited for him in the stairs, under the stairs, with a big knife. soon as he walked, he turned the light on, the person jumped on him, stuck the knife in his heart, big knife like this, in the middle of his heart, cut the heart to three pieces. The heart was cut, three different cuts. How many people in history got saved from such a stab? Probably only him in history. So he was, right away he died, within a minute he died. His father heard screaming. When he fell, he screamed, from the pain of the stabbing. And right away his father and his brother opened the door. They leave first floor. It's lucky they leave first floor. If it would be the second floor, they wouldn't hear him. He would be dead there forever. They came down, they saw tons of blood all over. Right away, the brother brought the car, they pulled him, they took him to Belinson. It's about 20 minutes ride from Paradis Katz to the hospital in Israel. All this time is completely dead, no pulse, no breath, no nothing, and dripping blood all over the car. When they arrived to the hospital, look how many miracles happened one after the other from the minute he got stabbed. They arrived to the hospital, they got to the front of the emergency room, they opened the door, they started to scream, bring a bed, bring a bed. So there was one cardiologist that just finished working in a hospital coming out of the door, the same second. And he saw right away a person wounded all over his chest with blood. He knew it's a heart case. Right away he turned back, put his clothes on right away, quickly ran to the emergency room, tried to do everything they can, electric shots, this, that's it. They gave up. He died. They covered him with a sheet, and a few minutes they're ready to transfer him to the refrigerator. There's a big refrigerator when they take the dead bodies there. 43 minutes he was dead, covered with sheets. According to science, if a person is dead more than 6 minutes, even if he comes back to life, his brain is damaged permanently. He can never, ever recuperate. His memories erased and many other problems. Paralyzed, problems with the systems of his body, all kinds of problems. But he got up and his case was sent to almost every hospital in the world. This story was about, I believe, about 16, 17 years ago. So his story was all over. It sends to America, to Europe, to show the doctor, just when you think you saw everything, there is always an exception to the rule. Don't rush the dead people to the refrigerators. Wait 3-4 hours at least. Don't rush. Here, 43 minutes, no pulse, no oxygen, no nothing. Completely dead. His body became ice. After a few minutes, the body temperature dropped. No feeling. You can burn him, you can cut him, he doesn't make a beep. And he came back to life. Why do I tell you about him? He made a tape about his story. There are a few millions of people like him, Jews and non-Jews in the world, that can describe what happened to the soul from the minute they died and came back to life. It's called out-of-body experience. The soul comes out of the body. It's called clinical death. And he said that his trial began. And his name is Avi Hajani, but how Avi in Hebrew, it's really Avraham. That's the real name that his parents call him in his Brit. But the problem is that when your name is Avraham, nobody call you in Israel Avraham. It's either Avi or Avram. That's it. So when he got there, of course, the person is very nervous because he doesn't know what to expect. He didn't learn Torah all his life to know what to expect. He has no idea what's going on. It's very nervous. There's a huge whistle, noise. He saw angels, he saw everything. And then he hears such a loud voice. He says, this is his words, I never forget that. I heard this tape maybe 16 years ago. He said that if you take all the stereo systems in the world combined in full volume, it won't even be anything compared to how loud the voice was. And the whistle is unbearable. And then he hears Avraham with echo, ham, 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 ham. Like so scary, who's calling me Avraham? Nobody ever called me Avraham. Avi, few times in my life, Avraham. And then he started to see a movie about all his life, everything, all the crimes, all the things. He was lucky for whatever reason, he got permission to come back to life. 99.999% of the people don't come back. You're dead, you're finished. There's no way to correct. As long as you're alive, you can correct all the sins you made. You died, it's over. That's it. You cannot make mitzvot, you cannot make any more sins when you're dead. When you're alive, your free choice is working, to do good or bad, to listen to God, to go against Him. And of course, many people ask this question. That's what makes a lot of people commit sins. That they say, look, I'm not keeping Shabbat. God didn't do anything to me. I didn't die. The Torah said that someone who doesn't keep Shabbat is dead, is going to die. But I'm alive. I'm alive and healthy. No cholesterol, no problem. I don't see any problem. Here, 20 years, I'm not Shomer Shabbat. Everything is fine. I'm a thief. Nobody ever hit me. No thieves broke into my home. All the money I stole so far I have in my bank account. So where is the justice? I make sins. I have a Goya girlfriend. I make sins with her every day, a few times. I'm perfectly fine. Even though it's the most horrible sins in the Torah, because Jews are the children of God and not allowed to mix with anyone. But everything is fine. Nobody touched me. Right? So what's why a person doesn't get punished immediately? Why? The answer is, if everyone will get rewarded when he do a mitzvah, a good thing, or he get punished right away when he makes a sin, there's no test. God said that the reason he put the soul in a body and he put the soul in this physical world is a test. To earn eternity, or God forbid, to go to a place, I don't want to even tell you where. It's one way or the other. You earn or you lose. There's no in between. So if everyone would earn right away, everyone would be righteous. What's the question? Everyone will learn Torah. Everyone will be modest. Everyone will be generous. Everyone will never say bad about everyone. Everyone will be polite. Nobody will be a thief. What? How can I be a thief? I steal $100. A second later, someone stole $200 from me. Like the Torah say, you lose double. I stole another time to see what's going to happen. Again, right away, I lost $200. I say, you know what? Let's give it a third chance. I stole for the third chance. Right away, I lose. So do you know anyone would continue to make sins? Everyone who makes a sin right away gets a slap. Nobody would make a sin. Everyone who does a good thing gets right away a reward. Nobody would stop making mitzvot. Everyone will do all day mitzvot, nothing else. Why? You see immediate profit. That's why God say, just trust me, I'm not a liar. You can trust me. Maybe other people you can trust, but me you can trust. I'm the God of the justice who does not receive bribe from anyone and judge everyone in the end exactly how he deserves. If you trust me and listen to me, you'll be a big winner. If not, God forbid, who knows what's gonna be with you. And that's what's happened to us. That since we don't see an immediate response, we tend to forget what's the mission that we have in life. So I started to say, we are not allowed to imitate people because every person has a unique test in his life. One has to be a sergeant, one has to be a rabbi, one has to be a butcher, one has to be a mohel. And a pretty girl, for instance. Why Hashem made her pretty? Why one girl is pretty, one girl is ugly? What's the reason? Coincidence? The machine made a mistake? It didn't put enough ink? The picture didn't come so clear. What's the reason? The answer is, in the previous life, those two girls were in different bodies. One was very proud about her look, and she felt she wasn't modest. She was making sins because of her beauty. The guy started with her, and she enjoyed the attention. She was making sins without getting married, going from one guy to another, making big sins. So what happened? She fell. If God wants to give her another chance, He reincarnate her again in a beautiful body. If He reincarnate her in a very ugly body, what test she has? Nobody wants to look at her. Nobody wants to talk to her. She doesn't have a test. She wants to make sins, but nobody wants to make sins with her, so she doesn't have a test. So she must be extremely pretty in order for her to be tested. Or if a girl, for instance, already passed that test, she was pretty, and she stayed modest. She got married, she had a husband, she was a faithful wife, She never let a man talk to her, touch her, or do any sins with her. She doesn't have to be pretty. She'll be average. Why? She doesn't have that test anymore. Same thing, money. Why one person is a multimillionaire, the other one is average? The millionaire has been tested if he's going to give charity or not. The other one who doesn't have millions already passed the test in his previous life. He still has to correct things that he's weak with. You understand? And the same thing about ego, anger, laziness, and many other things. Now, if you imitate a person, you are not him. He has a test and you have a different test. Why are you trying to imitate him? Like sometimes people try to be a rabbi. It's not your job in life. You can't. Hashem didn't put you in the world to teach Torah. It's not your purpose in life. Yes, you learn Torah, you do whatever you want, but that's not the purpose in your life. But a person is pushing and pushing and pushing and it just doesn't work. And he wastes 20 years of his life. And what happened in the end? He comes to Shamayim, Hashem says, how many hints you want? How many times I hinted to you that that's not your job? Or in other things. I give you an example. Some people, when they see blood, they faint. Somebody like this can be a butcher, can slaughter a cow. Did you ever see what happened when he slaughtered a cow? River of blood comes from the neck right away, next to your legs. River of blood, like spilling a huge bucket of water, but instead of water, blood. And the cow start to move like this, horrible. I one time saw in YouTube, 20 seconds, I felt sick all day. But some people grab the knife, one after the other. How can it be? People who born in Mazal Ma'adim, in a horoscope, we have 12 signs in a horoscope. Every sign is different. Different personality, different Mazal, different everything. People who born in Mazal Ma'adim, Ma'adim comes from the word Adom, red, blood. They have strong desire to spill blood. How are they going to spill the blood? It depends on their free choice. In a kosher way, or in a not kosher way. For instance, to slaughter the cow, it's mitzvah from the Torah. Not allowed to shoot and eat the animals. You have to slaughter them. Why you have to slaughter them? Because they have two cords. All the kosher animals have only two cords in the front. The non-kosher animals also have two in the back. But only the few kosher animals, the sheep, the cow, the deer, the kosher animals that are allowed to be eaten by Jews, they have only two cords of blood in the front. As soon as the knife go, that's it, there's no pain. Everything that the animal move, it's reflex. It's messages that the brain already sent to the nerve system before cutting the cords, which means it makes all kinds of movement in the body, but really there's no pain involved. It looks horrible, but there's no pain. But when you shoot the animal, it takes 2 or 3 minutes until the animal dies with horrible pain, just like with a person. If someone chopped the person's head right away, in one shot, he doesn't feel anything. In less than a tenth of a second, the nerve system does not work. But if you stab him 20, 30 minutes, he's suffering a lot. So even when there is a mitzvah to eat the animal, make sure that the animal don't suffer. When you eat, you have to make sure the animal eat first. As long as the animal alive, make sure that your animal, even a dog, will never suffer. The chickens, you have to feed them, you have to throw the weeds on the floor, then you sit and eat. There are rules about the animals. God cares about the animals, of course. But if we want to eat meat now, Yom Tov, Shabbat, mitzvah to eat, we got to do it in a way that it's going to be a kosher way. So like I said, if a person was born in Ma'adim, he can be a murderer, or he can be slaughtering animal, or moel, cutting, making brit milah, it's also full of blood. Other person who wasn't born in Ma'adim cannot see blood. See blood? I see a needle shot, I almost faint. Just the blood coming to the bag, get goosebumps all over my body. Some people, that doesn't bother them. Right away, one needle after the other, cutting, surgery, doctor, tons of blood comes out. Doesn't bother them. Why? Depends where you're born. And many other examples. Now the Torah says like this. There are three kinds of, there are three kinds of connections God has with his Jewish nation. After he told us in Mount Sinai, you are my children, I chose you from all the nation. You're not allowed to mix with any other nation. You're not allowed to dress like them. You're not allowed to use their name. You're not allowed to eat their food. You're not allowed to marry them. All these things, I isolate you from all the nation to be mine. Your heaven and their heaven is completely different. Yours is a much higher level. The Gentiles, they can keep seven laws, the seven laws, and they are righteous Gentiles, but the heaven is very low. But the Jew has much higher mission in life. As the Torah say, you are my children, I chose you from all the nation to be mine. I'm holy, you have to be holy because I'm holy. The Torah says like this, there are three different languages of love in the Torah between God and the nation of Israel. What are they? One, dvika, sticking, like taking glue and stick two things together and you cannot separate them. That's one way. Second, chashika, strong desire, like between a man to a woman. He wants to marry her in 2-3 weeks. It's the wedding. He cannot stop thinking about him. He's already in love with her. No, when is the wedding going to be? When? I can't wait. Or her or him. They both think all day. They can eat. They can think. Somebody talk to them. They don't listen. At work, they make mistakes. Why? Their mind is somewhere else. That's called chashika, cheshek, desire. And chafitza, chafetz, wanting. Very, very thin differences between one word to another. Very difficult to tell the difference. But in Hebrew, in the holy language, the language of God, you never have two words that have the same meaning. If, even if it sounds very similar, there is a little bit difference between one to another. Let's see what the Torah says about serving God with happiness in this world. First, it says in Tehillim, Psalms, chapter 100, chapter Kuf, verse 2. Ivdu et Hashem besimcha. Serve God with happiness. Come in front of Him with joy. Make sure whenever you do in life, never dare to complain. You have no idea how lucky you are that you're a Jew. You have no idea. All the nations throughout history, from the minute God chose the Jews, never stop hating the Jews. I'm not talking every Gentile in the world. There are righteous Gentiles who love the Jews. No, of course, we know it. But in general, the nations, all the time, there's no country who the United Nations vote against them, anything near Israel. Almost all the anti in the United Nations is always against Israel and the Jews. Something like this you never find in history. Countries like Syria, murdering tons of people every day, shooting and demonstrating, chopping them, torturing them in jail. Iran, Russia, China, Libya, the most cruel people in the history, not one beep against them in the United Nations. Israel built the building in Jerusalem, the Holy Land that belongs to us 3,000 years. The whole world is screaming and hating us for building a building to our children in our homeland. That the whole world admit that the Torah is the word of God. Remember, these Christians and Muslims who sit in the United Nations and all the time busy how to smash and kill Israel, they all admit in their schools, in their churches, in their mosques, that God gave the Jews the Torah. They call it the Old Testament. In the Quran, it says, the Torah is holy. The Torah was given to Musa, Moshe. It says in the Quran. And in the Quran, it doesn't say anything about Jerusalem, the opposite. It says in the Quran, and I show it in my seminar, you can go into the lectures, it will be posted tonight. About half an hour, I show verses from the Quran that says that Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, belong only to the Jews. In the Quran, it says that God gave it to the Jews. I show maybe 7 or 8 sources from the Quran. But the Israeli politicians are so ignorant in Torah, they have no idea what's going on. Not one of them ever thought to stand in the United Nations and say, ladies and gentlemen, I have a nice surprise for you. I came to teach you Quran today. Everyone would see the Israeli, what, they crazy? It's drunk? What did you drink? You say, here, surah, such and such. Surah, that's the sources. And he begins to read, and they'll hide, you know, the Arabs will run out from the embarrassment, and they won't return for a year to the United Nations building from the embarrassment. Do you know that? But nobody knows. Not one person had the brain to stand and read parts from the Quran to show that Israel, everything, all the way up to Syria, belongs to the Jews, according to the Quran. And everybody knows there was no Palestinian nation 100 years ago. Never. Never. The Jewish nation is the oldest nation in the world. Us and the Chinese. The only two nations that are at least 4,200 years exist, it's us and the Chinese. Nobody else has record like us and the Chinese people. And what's happened? All of a sudden, a nation that two, three generations, nobody knew who they are. No flag, no anthem. No citizenship, no country, no army, nothing. All of a sudden, they come, they claim that their land belongs to them, and the whole world supporting them. Do you think the world cared about them? The world hates Israel because God chose the Jews and made them special, and it kills them. So there are two kinds of Gentiles. Some who it kills them, so they go against Israel. And some that are a little bit more clever. They say, if God loved the Jews so much, I might as well become a Jew. That's what's happening here. It's either this or that. And some just don't think. They don't have any opinion. They don't love, they don't hate, they don't care about anything. They're here, but they're really not here. They're not aware of what's going on. So, just if a Jew knows how lucky he is that from all the 7 billion people in the world, there are 13.2 million Jews, and each one of them is a precious diamond that God chose, instead of complaining that I have to keep the mitzvot, he would be dancing on the street. You know, like the crazy people, how they run in the street because they have nothing to worry about. They're not worried. They're happy. I know a crazy woman in Israel. Every time I used to go visit my grandmother, she was there. Every time she saw me from the street, she coming out, screaming in the whole neighborhood. She was so happy to see me. She's not thinking. Yeah, a, you know, woman that she stayed lonely. She never got married. And over the years, she became not so normal. But you should see how she was always laughing to herself. All of a sudden, I used to see her standing in the street, laughing, rolling on the floor from laughing. And I say, I remember as a young man, I was 16, 17, I used to think to myself, I never got so happy in my life like this woman. So who's really miserable, me or her? All day, because the people that have no brain, I mean the brain do not function, they don't suffer. Most of the suffering that we have, we created for ourselves, do you know? Because we don't have faith in God. So we always worry, what's going to be, I'm going to pay the rent, how I'm going to pay mortgage, how I'm going to get married, how I'm going to buy my wife a ring, how I'm going to pay for yeshivot, how I'm going to have children, how I'm going to stay healthy, how. So many hows that a person becomes depressed, of course. Now on my way here, I just drove here 10 hours straight. So on my way here, the guy that was sitting next to me in a car, he just told me that the doctors in America considering giving people ecstasy drugs to treat their failing marriages, because almost every couple has so many problems. So they like to create like a virtual game, like a demo. You know, forget about real life, forget about reality. Let's give them drugs to make them think that they're happy. At least there's not going to be so much complaint. You understand what's going on here in this world? I can't believe this. They came to the conclusion that the situation is so bad, there's no way to treat it. You know what? So let's pretend that everyone is happy, like this crazy woman in Israel. So people will take medication, and they walk in the street, at work, all of a sudden. One guy once told me that he took that pill, and he was in a party. And after that, he took it, it made him feel like so hyper or happy, I don't know how to describe it, that he went to the kitchen for 3 hours, he washed all the dishes of 300 people. You know, like when you're happy, you don't care what to do. You clean someone's shoe if you're happy. You don't care. So happy, you won the lottery, let's say. You care? Well, you're so excited, so you scream, you do stupid things. Ay, 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 ay. So The Tehillim say like this, Ivdu et Hashem besimcha bol fanav birnana. Serve Hashem, serve God with happiness, come in front of Him with joy. And also in Tehillim, in 68, chapter 68, verse 4, Vetzadikim ismechu, the righteous people will gain happiness. Ya'altzu lifne Elokim, will have joy in front of God. Ve'yasisu besimcha. They'll be in the highest level of happiness, but real happiness, not because they drank some Johnny Walker or something. Real happiness. There's fake happiness and real happiness that comes from the heart and stays forever. Then, now it's about to teach something that is extremely important. Let's say a person comes to me and say, I love your lecture, beautiful, you speak about happiness, fine. I don't want to be happy. I'm good the way I am. What's the problem? I'm sad, I'm angry. What's the problem? So what's the problem? No, who knows what's the problem? Who knows what's the problem? What's the problem of being so... So I won't be happy. Let me tell you what the problem is. The Torah is teaching us that if a person is a prophet... Yeah, thank you. You read my mind. The cup is dirty. I don't know what happened. All right, thank you very much. So the Torah is teaching us something very interesting. Someone is a prophet. You know what a prophet means? From all the millions of people in the world, God chose him to talk to him. What does it tell you about this person? He's much better than us, no? God doesn't speak to us, no? It's too hot here, Rabbi. Very hot. Extremely hot. So the question is like this. If a person is a prophet, God speaks to him and show him the future, and he has a vision. Once he becomes sad, what we call depressed today, he's sad, he's down, he loses his prophecy immediately. If a Jew has a connection with God, he's doing a lot of great things and he feels very inspired, 1, 5, 10 minutes of sadness, he loses all the influence and all the positive influence that God has on him. You know, we have a say, mitzvah goreret mitzvah, avera goreret avera. Translation, when a person starts a roll of mitzvot, he does mitzvah, Hashem opens him another window for another mitzvah. Just like in a computer, windows. One leads you to another, and another window open, and another one. And it's a roll. It can be thousands. Why you just made 1,000 mitzvot? You started with one on your choice, and God started to send you one after the other. Same thing, a sin. Person start to make a sin, one thing leads to another. One thing leads to another. Until a person cannot get out of his situation. He start with something small, and who knows what happened. I give you an example. Today, we have a very common problem with our youth. What's the problem? First of all, not everyone religious, we understand. So, some people becoming religious. Now they go on a date. After a date or two, they cannot hold themselves. Now they decided that they really want each other. They see chemistry. They see some love is being created. And he's thinking, that's going to be my wife. And she's thinking, I'm going to marry this guy. And what happened? Instead of holding themselves 2, 3, 4 months until they finally become legally married, they begin to touch each other. He holds her hand. And a little bit, you know, her arm, or he walks with her on the street, so he touches her back a little bit. So he's thinking, God doesn't care about touching her hand. Well, come on, it's not Iran here. It's the 21st century here. But surprisingly, it always starts with the hand, and the next day it's the arm, and then it's the shoulder, and then it's the face. And then she has to become a murderer. when she make an abortion 2-3 months later. What made her murderer and him, both of them, what made the murderers? That he puts his hand on her hand for the first time. If he would listen to God not to touch her, or she would listen to God not to let any man touch her until her wedding, not to talk about the future will be beautiful and everything in her marriage will be fantastic with great harmony and peace, because God would be so proud of this modest girl that she listens to me and she didn't let a man touch her until she became officially a kala, a wife. Of course I'm going to bless her. What's the question? What, I'm going to punish her for holding her desire not to go and make sin and let any man touch her? Of course, she's going to get the best blessing. What do you think? You do what God told you and you get punished for it? What's going on here? Why people come to the wrong conclusion? That's called Shomer Negiah. Watching that nobody touch you. She has red lines. She never let a man make a full sin with her. Of course, nah, Rabbi, come on, nah. It's in our family, you know, we were very observant. My father will kill me if he find out. But she doesn't understand that all the full sins that ended up very bitter started with a little touch and a hug and then a little kiss, and then it leads to things that's it, they cannot control themselves. And even if it didn't end with a murder or an abortion or anything like this, or a horrible disease or who knows what, once they finally get married, even not to each other, each one separately. She went in the end marry another guy, and he went and marry another girl. They're going to suffer for the rest of their life for these sins. You cannot get away with that. Because you started it corrupted, rotten. The foundation of your life is rotten. It's not stable. You suffer for the rest. You cannot build 100 floors on foundations that are weak or crooked or who knows what. But we're lucky that God gave us the option to make repentance. Many of us could make sins, and then one day we wake up and say, you know what, I didn't know all these things. My parents never told me. The public school I went to, the opposite, they encourage these things. They just tell you, don't do the right thing. Just make sure you don't get sick. They tell you all kinds of advices. You can make sins. They're not against it. Just make sure it's safe, the sins, that you won't end up dead in a few months. And the kids, that's the way they raise them. Nobody tells them the truth. Nobody tells them. Did you ever ask yourself how the Hasidim, they meet 1 hour, they get married, and they have the lowest divorce rate in the entire world? No other nation, no other city in the world has lower divorce rate than the Hasidim. And I say especially Hasidim, not other religious people. By other religious people that are modern, that they mingle and mix with the Goyish society, they pay the price. The Hasidim, they block themselves from the world. Sometimes they lose in certain things, I'm not saying no. But when it comes to modesty, when they finally meet each other, they get married and have no problem. You should see. I saw now, I was in Toronto. I saw a couple of Hasidim there, husband and wife. I like to follow things. I always like to back up what I teach. In reality, I want to check if it's really true, all the statistics that they say. You should see. Fantastic marriages. You see how the wife talks to the husband, how he talks to her, how the kids love the parents, how that's together. And they only met 1 hour and they got married. No, how can it be? Very simple. The answer is like this. When a person tries many things, he gets confused. When there's the time to make a final choice, he doesn't know what to choose. He saw 50 cars. One guy was working in a car wash. So I told him, what car you recommend I should buy? I'll tell you the truth, I drove more than 100 different cars. Maybe this one is good. No, this one. No, wait, this car is better. In 1 hour, he already told me maybe 20, 30 different names. I said, you know what, you got me more confused now. What is it? I'll explain to you what I mean. When a person grow up, age 15, 16, he start making sin. Jews, non-Jews, clubs, these, drugs, alcohol, parties. it seems that they enjoy for a certain period of time. But then when the time comes to get married, almost all of them get divorced right away. They can't hold the marriage. Why? When you got mixed with so many different things, you cannot. You always compare your wife or your husband to what you've been experiencing in the past. And it drives you crazy, and there's always problem, and you're never satisfied. But this kind of kids is 18, 19. First time in his life, he talks to a girl. I know it sounds very primitive, but we are not saying what God told us to do. What do you think? God is primitive? He doesn't know what he's talking about. The creator of relationship doesn't know what's the best recommendation. He made a man, he made a woman, he made the marriage institution, he made everything. And he tells you this is the only way. Not the best way, but there are other good ways. The only way. Pay attention. Sometimes you have a few good ways. You open a business like this, you make $1 million a year. You open that business, you made 100,000. No, so what? So you made 800,000. It's not, that doesn't have to be perfect. Over here, it's either everything or zero. There's no other alternative way. That's what people don't understand. It's either the way of God or nothing will work. So he never spoke to a girl in his life. They watched their eyes. They sanctified their name by learning Torah, mikvah, everything. Their entire environment is clean. And all of a sudden, what happened? One day, they put him in front of a girl. For the first time in his life, he sits face to face with a girl. Not the prettiest in the world. Not, like the best bargain. Right away, so excited from her, because he doesn't know what to compare her to. And that's a connection that will stay forever. And the same thing by her. She never spoke to a guy. Sometimes you wonder, you see, you know, among the Ashkenazim Hasidim, their wives, if they would not be religious, each one of them would be Miss Universe with their beauty. There's beauty that is very hard to find. And they meet guys with long beards that everyone say, how can it be? I mean, these guys are not handsome, like in a magazine or in the movies. How this woman, I mean, you know, like she will get the best movie stars. Because we are thinking in a rotten way, the way we were raised in the rotten society. By them, it's all spiritual. It's different than what we have. This is what people don't get. The connection, like I say, when you don't compare, you have nothing to compare it. I always like to give this story of a person who landed in an island with his father. They had a little car with them. Lousiest car. We call in Israel Susita. You know what Susita is? A fiberglass car made from fiberglass. You leave it by the desert, the camel come and eat it. I'm serious. You leave it 3-4 hours somewhere in the desert, one camel come, begin to eat your hood. You come after an hour, you have a big hole. It will be good for you for the business. Half of the car was eaten. It's serious. They have the biggest joke, this car, and they make so much noise and vibration, horrible cars. You know, make them already 30 years. And as a kid, it was the car in Israel. I think it's made in Israel. The only car Israel ever made. It's called Susita. Sus, it's a horse. Susita means they want to give the car a compliment. It's fast like a horse. So, a person never saw another car. He was landed with his father, the plane crashed, and in the plane there was this Susita. The father, Lo Aleinu, passed away, the little baby grew up, and one day see the car has the key, he started the car, noise, all car is shaking, noise, no heat, no air condition, nothing. The car is crooked, but drives. All the Indians in the island, all the Congo people, Mambu Mambu, I don't know, all these people, like naked with spears like this, what do they have? If they're lucky, they have a horse. They all see the car, they go crazy. They never saw a car. And he doesn't know there's other cars in the world, in America, in Europe. That's what he saw in his life. So he's driving like a king, and all these Congo people bowing down to him in the island. Why? Well, it's like their god. Well, look how he has a machine, he drives, he's like a UFO. He came from a different planet. One day, another plane crashed over there with the top of the line Mercedes.
quiet, nice, leather seat, no vibration, no everything. And the new driver drives next to him. From the minute the owner of that Susita saw the other car, can he continue to enjoy from his Susita? What happened? That's what's happened, you understand? The more you experience, the more confused you get. Even the good that you have become nothing in your eyes. This is a psychological problems. The more you look, the more you compare, you don't enjoy. Yeah, that's the way the people are. Many, I give you an example. One person built a house, 2,000 square feet. He lived in a tiny little apartment, he couldn't move. He was so happy from his house. Then he started to work in service, going to do plumbing in houses. He went to such mansion, he couldn't look at his house from that moment on. I thought I have a nice house. From the minute he saw every chandelier where he comes to fix the things, it's already more than his whole house. Big gates, doormans, beautiful driveway, 100,000 landscaping. I look at my house, it's like a shed. It's not a house. But before he started with his job, he was more than happy with his house. And it was real happiness. He was very satisfied. That's what makes people always not happy. So look, before we finish, I want to tell you this. It's very interesting. It says like this, look. Moshcheni acharecha narutza. King Solomon wrote, Shir HaShirim, chapter 1, verse 4. Eviani amelech adarav, the king brought me into his room. Who is the king? God brought me into his room. If you come to the king's house, or forget about the king, the president, you go to the White House. If Obama brings you into his bedroom, what's the whole world understand? That you his best buddy, right? People don't even let their own brother in their bedroom. No? Yeah, I know someone just painted his house. The house was complete mess. There, the kids destroyed the house. And his bedrooms as well, because the kids destroyed the room. So he painted the whole house. He left his room like this. So I said to him, why you didn't paint your room? So I cannot have somebody go into my bedroom, even though the painter is his best friend. I can't have someone in my bedroom. Hey, matter of modesty. Let it stay like this, who cares? As long as the house is okay, he can stay up to my door. If the king brought you into his room, that means it's a very important relationship. Eviani amelech adarav nagila venismecha bach. That's a real happiness when I'm close to him. If the president lets you in his room, you know how happy you should be? Wow. I guess I'm really important in this country. And it says like this. Kol ma shezocheh adam likanes, the more a person enter more private rooms of God, which means there are levels. You're starting to come closer and closer, and he brings you closer to him and show you more secrets and show you his supervision in your life. And you see miracle one after the other. Here, what happened to us here, Rabbi, before we started the shiur? I came from Canada. When I went to Canada, I took with me 2 full batteries of this camera. Each one is good for 6-7 hours. You know, well, more than that, 600 minutes, 500 minutes, about 8 hours almost. And I didn't know my schedule will be so tight. If you look at this brochure, you won't believe. 4 or 5 lectures, almost 2 hours every day for 3 days. It's a lot of... So the camera, and plus, after you take the lectures of Shabbat, which we couldn't film anyway, in the end, one battery finished, the second battery was almost finished now. When I turned the camera, I said, wow, I don't have the charger. I didn't carry the charger with me. What am I going to do? I'm not going to be able to film this shiur. So I called Reuven from Torah Anytime. I know he lives about a mile away, some 2 miles away. So you know what, maybe he's going to do a favor and bring us a battery. So I called him up. And he said to me, I said, can you bring a camera? You know, I don't have a battery. So he says to me, no, unfortunately, I'm on the way to somewhere important. I said, wow, I don't know what to do. Does anybody that has a camera in the area, maybe I can borrow a battery from him tonight? He said, no. All of a sudden, he said, okay, you know what, wait for me outside in 2 minutes. A minute later, I came out. He was right here. He brought me a brand new battery. He was going, I don't want to say in front of the camera, I was going to an extremely important place.
And he needed like a real bracha for the place that he goes. So he said, you know what? I'm happy I came. Now you give me bracha that I'll be successful in what I do. I say, don't you understand? I came after teaching Torah 3 days straight. You know, I'm full of inspiration. I feel it like electric. I say to him, you know what? I gave it from all my heart. Who knows? Maybe the whole thing with this battery, it's all supervised. Hashem show you. In less than a minute, I had a battery here. Ah, Rabbi, that's how it was, right? Exactly. But this is a tiny thing. There's so many other things that you see in life. But if you elevate your emunah, Hashem shows you. You have to understand, you're not going to smoke grass all day and drink l'chaim and make scenes and think, why, where is God in my life? Why I don't see anything? It's not going to work. You either listen to him and you begin to see, or you don't listen. You don't see anything, of course. And I'm lying below you. They have eyes, but they cannot see. They have ears, but they cannot hear. Why? I block it. I block their eyes. I block their ears. You want to see my miracles? You make the first step. I'm not your friend from high school. You start to listen to me 2, 3, 4 months, and everything will turn around in your life. You want me to dance according to your music, the flute? Not going to work. Don't test me. That's what the Torah says. Do not test your God. Do not test me. How many people say, Rabbi, you want me to be religious? Fine, I agree. In one condition. Already it sounds horrible. In one, what? When I get married, I'll be religious. It's easy for you to talk. You have a wife, children. You come, Shabbat, you sit, you enjoy singing, eating, the wife cooking, delicious food. Guests are coming. Of course, everyone would enjoy it. But look at me, I'm alone, I'm lonely. I have to do Shabbat on my own. Nobody, I'm alone. You know, there's a lot of excuses. And at some point, I always think, not allowed to talk because we don't want God to put us in this test. But I'm always jealous with these single people that have a peace of mind to see the whole Shabbat and learn Torah and nobody bothers them. Not 50 guests, not the kids, not this, now go here, come here. Dark, you come, you make quick kiddush, 10 minutes kiddush, eat a quick meal, amotzi, 5 minutes, finish, you sit, you take your books, you sit all Shabbat under the lamp, you're in heaven. I always think to myself, but maybe after you do, you be like this, then you miss the noise. I don't know. But anyway, so it says like this. It says like this. Ismach Israel be'osav, bnei Tzion yagilu be'malkam. The nation of Israel should be very happy that they have the merit to do for God. Not that God needs anything from us, God forbid. But he puts us in a test. Bnei Tzion, the children of Zion, Yagilu, rejoice with their kingdom. And who is speaking here? King David, that reached the highest level a person can reach almost. And it says like this, Ye'erav alav sichi, anochi esmach be'ashem. What does it mean, Ye'erav? Every morning when we say Birkot HaShachar, what do we say? Ve'arev na Hashem Elokeinu et divrei Toratecha befinu. What's arev means delicious. Delicious. That's the word. Arev, wow, I love this food. Arev lechiki. Delicious in my mouth, in my throat. That's what it means. So this is an expression, a parable. Ve'arev na, make your Torah delicious in our mouth. Not that we learn just because we have to learn, because we want to get rewarded. No. Get us to the level what you promised, that when someone learns Torah, it's the greatest fun you can think of. More than anything you can think of. But you have to pray for it. So what do we say? Ve'arevna et divrei Torah, the words of your Torah, make them sweet in our mouth. David HaMelech writes like this, look. Ye'erav alav sichi. Sichi means siach. Lesocheach, to talk. While I speak to God is so delicious. That's why I'm so happy. This is words that comes from the heart. I will come to the altar of God that makes me so happy, El Simchat Gili, and will thank you with my violin. You know what it means? You know, David HaMelech, You know, his wife saw him dancing in front of the Ark of Hashem. They take the Ark, everyone goes, you know, like sometimes you have on the street, Achnasat Sefer Torah, they bring the Torah into the shul, everyone walks, they play music. So imagine now you see the biggest rabbi in the world dancing, like, excuse my language, like Meshuga, dancing, doing all kinds of things. So his wife told him, you're embarrassing me. What are you doing? You're a king. Cannot jump like this, like Meshuga on the street. And she stayed barren for the rest of her life. That was her punishment. You know what's going on here? Because he was so happy from his closeness to Hashem for the honor that he gave to the Torah, that it came 100% pure from his heart. And she was thinking about what the people's gonna say. My husband, they think it's crazy. What did she do between you and I? It happens to many rabbitsen today. Hey, be quiet, you're embarrassing me. Sometimes the man likes to make noise. So, not when it comes lichvod Hashem. When it's for Hashem, Hashem is very happy. You know the stipler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, when he used to finish something that he learns, people used to follow him. They peek from the window. He used to get up, an old man, go holding the book, go around the table where he was learning, dancing, crying from happiness. Where in our life we got to such level that we are so happy that we laugh and cry and shake and run like Meshuga around the things? How? Ay, 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 ay. Teranena sfatai ki azamra lach. My lips are happy that they have the merit to sing for you, God. Benafshi asher padita, and my soul that you redeem. Tachat, well, you know, the Torah says something that is really, really scary. And nobody pays attention to it. If you come and ask, why the nation of Israel suffers so much? The answer you get, they don't want to listen to God. They don't follow the rules. So what happened? They get punished. Is that what the Torah says? Yes and no. Yes, of course, that's the reason. But it's a little bit deeper than this. I'm going to read to you a verse from Deuteronomy 28. Verse 47, Sefer Dvarim, Kafchet, Mem Zayin. The Torah says like this, Tachat asher lo avadta et Hashem Elokecha besimcha ubetuv levav. Because you did not follow your God with happiness and great feeling in your heart, you are getting punished all this punishment. Not that you didn't keep, not that you were not religious. Very religious, from the outside. Beard, yarmulke, tzitzit, everything. Learn Torah, come with tefillin, 6 o'clock in the morning, a call. But your face is like this. Ma, what happened? Hard, hard. Life is hard. Life is hard, huh? You're making $1 billion every minute, life is hard. You know what's the reward of one mitzvah? One mitzvah, do you know the reward of one mitzvah? Where do we see in the Torah a proof that if you take the entire world will not pay you for one time you say a bracha on a drink? Here, I just said before, Sha'akol Nia Bidvaro, I already earned the entire earth, it's in my pocket. Where does it say in the Torah? This is a divine book, not Ali Baba's story, or Quran, or Christianity that's full of baloney. The real book of God, it says over there, everything you can think of will not be enough to pay you for one tiny mitzvah, tiny commandment that you made. Where does it say? Tell you a story. 2,500 years ago, approximately, there was a prophet Isaiah, Isaiah. He was the prophet. And at that time, there was a very righteous king in Israel. His name was King Hezekiah. Perhaps he was the greatest king ever lived. Why? Because nowhere the nation of Israel never reached the level that they reached in his time. It was the greatest, it was the record, the highest spiritual situation that the Jewish nation ever achieved. What does it mean? Every 6 years old boy, that today they behave like monkeys in our generation, every 6 years old boy, what is it, first grade? I don't even know, six or pre-1A, sixth grade, see, first grade? First grade. So every 6 years old boy already knew the entire Torah. Think about it. If you come today to a lecture and a little first grade would come, like this with his candy bag, and give you 5 hours Torah in the highest level. Instead of 20 people to a lecture, it would be 20,000 people. Today, wow, you have to see this magic. A little kid come with his candy, lollipop, and he speak like Chacham Ovadia Yosef. Everything, Gmarot, everyone would be shocked. But oh, a million kids like this you had. Everyone, they got used to it. So somebody like this, and it's all thanks to him. He forced everyone to learn. You have no choice. No games. You must learn. If not, you get punished. And everybody learned. So one time, Hashem sent the prophet Yeshayahu, Isaiah, to tell him that he has to get killed. He has to get ready to leave the world. Why? He doesn't want to get married. Why he doesn't want to get married? As a handsome man, smart, the king, very rich, 5,000 girls a minute he can get to marry. He doesn't know who to choose from, so he'll die to be his wife. So why doesn't want to get married? He doesn't want to get married because he sees a vision that one of his kids will be very wicked. And he's going to be so bad that he's going to take statues and put them in places and bring Jews to bow down to these statues. What we call today Hinduism. There are Jews like this who follow all this nonsense and they have little Buddha, Buddhism and Hinduism. There are Jews like this. There are even Israelis like this. So, we saw that he has a son like this. He said, I'll suffer all my life without touching a woman. Now remember, this is a generation like today that a person is single all his life and he goes and makes sins because he cannot hold himself. This is a very holy man. Which means he agreed never once in his life to touch a finger of a woman or to look at a woman, to suffer all his life just because he doesn't want to have a wicked son like this that will make God so upset, that put idols on the land. So somebody like this, he's righteous, he deserves to die, or he deserves to be the Mashiach? What does he deserve to be? So why God wants to punish him? Listen good, it's very deep and very interesting. God sent the prophet to him and say, your time arrived. God told me to prepare you. You're going to the next world. And he said, why? What did I do wrong? He said, you never married a woman. He said, don't you and God knows that I'm not marry a woman because I see who's going to come out of me? He said, yes. Nachon, you see. But you're not God. And what does the Torah say? The first mitzvah in the Torah, you have to get married and have children. You must marry, you Jew, you must marry a Jewish woman or a Jewish woman marry a Jewish man and have Jewish children. You know, you marry the Goya, the children are Goyim. They're not your children. You have no connection to them in the afterlife. It's not a joke here. You marry and you have children and that's the mitzvah. Even if the kids will not be righteous, it's not, you're not God, you're not running the world. There's different reasons sometimes for things. You're not allowed to mix your personal opinion when you have a direct order in the book of God what to do, and it's a general order that applies to everyone. If God came to you and told you to do something individually, that's a different story. But since it's a general rule, it applies to all Jews with no exception. So, you say, okay. Chatati, I made a sin, you're right. I should have not mixed my own opinion. Okay, let me marry your daughter. The prophet has a daughter from a very good family. The king and the daughter of the prophet, very good. He say, okay, if it's up to me, I agree. But the question is what God wants. He say, okay, tell God that I'm going to pray now for him to forgive me and to give me enough time to have kids, to get married and to have kids. Then after a while, he came back to him. And he said to him, I have good news for you. God added 15 more years to your life. Hashem said, you're going to have exactly 15 more years now to live. Now you're going to get married today. And you're going to have enough time. You have a boy and a girl. You must have at least one boy and one girl. And the rest is extra.
If you have 15 boys, you didn't keep the mitzvah. 15 girls, you didn't keep the mitzvah. At least one boy and one girl, and everything else is extra. That's called pru urvu. That's the law. And not only that you have to have one boy and one girl, they have to be able to have to give birth. That they are not barren, not the boy and not the girl. If one of them is barren, you need another girl or another boy, depend. At least one boy and one girl that able to continue your descendants. So, what happened after that? After that, he said to the prophet, how do I know you're not cheering me up? Maybe you're just saying it to make me feel better. Give me a sign. So he says to him, you look at the sun. Let's say the sun's supposed to go down today at around 8. So he said to him, tonight the sun will stay in the center of the sky longer than usual. It will not go down on the right time. You know what it means? To interfere with the law of nature? To pause earth and sun? Who can do such a thing? Only the messenger of God. Is that a good sign for you? He say, yes. That's what will be. Four times in history it happened. Four times. This is one of the four. That's all. At night, everyone look at the sky. What's going on today? The sun, the night is not coming. In Iraq, which is the same time zone in Israel, like in Israel, Babylon, that was the empire of Babylon. They see over there that the sun is not going down. The goyim, they look up, they're surprised. Nebuchadnezzar, the biggest murderer, he said to his servant, I want you to take a horse and go all the way to Israel and ask the king and the people of Jerusalem there in the Holy Temple, if they know why the sun didn't go down today. So he writes a letter now. He takes a feather, puts in the ink, and this is what he wrote. To the king of Israel, Chizkiyahu, and to the people of Jerusalem, and to the people of Israel, and to their God, please tell me why the sun did not go down on this date. And he signed his signature with a stamp. He gives it to the messenger. The messenger is on a horse ready to leave. And then he said, wait, I made a mistake. He got up from his chair and he made three steps. One, two, three, to the horse. He took it back. He changed the first line. He said, it's not fair. I wrote God in the end of the sentence. It's not respect. So he rewrote to the God of the nation of Israel and to the king Chizkiyahu in the right order. That's all he did. That's the only good thing he did in his life. He was worse than Hitler, 20 times worse. He killed more than 20 million people. Jews, rivers of blood, destroyed the temple, the first temple that King Solomon did. Destroyed the house of God. Can you be more wicked than this? The worst person you can think of. What happened now? He made three steps, and that's it. The Torah says, shocking, mama, shocking. If somebody doesn't understand it, I feel very sorry for you. This is what it says. For the three steps that this horrible murderer made, God paid him 70 years of total control of the entire world. He was the king of the world for 45 years. 45 years a person control every inch of earth. Every person in the world pay him taxes. His army occupied the whole world. Much bigger than United States or China or Russia today. Complete control. Now one person in the world don't pay him tax. Think about it. Everyone. Everyone knows the king of the world. 45 years, his son took his place. 23 years he was the king of the world and his grandson 2 years. Together 70 years of full control of every inch of earth. The Torah says like this, come and learn from this murderer, despicable murderer, wicked goy named Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. He, for three steps that he did to respect God, he got 70 years of full control of every inch of the world. A Jew, when he walks to shul on Shabbat,
10, 20, 30 minutes, whatever, everyone will displace. Every second he makes 3 steps. 70 years full control. He has to get at least what this guy got, no? And he's going to get much more. Because he's not a murderer, despicable murderer who destroyed the house of God. God loves this Jew much better than this murderer, no? Without a doubt. But let's say just as much. Here, 3 steps, 70 years. 3 steps, 70 years. 3 steps, 70 years. Right away, 7,000 years, full control of earth. All the money, all the wealth, all the pleasure, all the honor, everything you can think of. This is for one time walking to shul. Now multiply it by 70 years of keeping mitzvot. 1 billion years of control for one Jew. Multiply it by 2 million religious Jews. How are you going to divide one little lousy world to 2 million people who needs to get billions of years of... It's impossible. So the conclusion, the reward is not in this world. This world is temporary. This is divine, eternal instructions. And the reward, or God forbid, the punishments are eternal. That's what people don't understand. If you're righteous, you get rewarded for eternity. If you're wicked, your punishment never ends. There are certain sins that the punishment is eternal. Such as Mechalel Shabbat, not keeping Shabbat, the covenant between the Jews and God. You know what's going on here? Yosef, we're learning in this parasha, last parasha, Joseph became the second king of Egypt. There's Pharaoh and then Yosef. Pharaoh took his ring, gave it to Yosef. You can write any letter you want, you can sign. You are the treasury. The treasury has more power than the king. Think about it. He controls all the money. He controls the decision. Everything is according to him. He controls all the money. And how old was he? 30 years old. Coming from jail, 12 years in jail. Think about it. Arrived to Egypt, 17. Go to jail. Coming out, age 30. Right away, Paro has the dream. This, Hashem turns everything around. He becomes the treasury of Egypt, age 30. Every person in the world was under the decision of Yosef. He took over all the real estate, all their field, everything, their animal, the gold, everything. Power, no? Yosef, before he became the treasury, before he went to jail, he was a beautiful, very handsome, but much good-looking person that the women in Egypt would fall on the floor to see his face. He was such a nice-looking person that they did everything they could. There is over there, right there on the shelf. Yeah? No? Yeah. So, yes. So, don't ask me how I knew. I don't know how I knew it's there. It's funny. Yeah. No, he first came without thinking, and then apparently it's there. So anyway, so what happened is, he was walking like this on the street. He was very religious. He grew up in his father, Yaakov Avinu, Jacob. So the women are falling on the floor to see his face. Think about it. Like Lehavdil, think about some famous, good-looking movie star who decided to be religious. Decided. So he left Hollywood. He left everything. And he went to Yerushalayim, to Yeshiva. And all the Israeli secular girls see him walking on the street. And he doesn't want them to see him. What would happen? They run after him, run to the car. Try to imagine the situation. Now Yosef is a servant in a house of Potiphar. He's the one who bought him when he arrived to Egypt. He put him to be the master of his home. He runs the show in the house. And the wife of Potiphar is one of the most 4 beautiful women ever live. Women that are pretty today look like a monkey compared to her beauty. If you look at her face, you faint immediately from her beauty. Try to imagine, I don't know. The world is full of, Baruch Hashem, beautiful faces that Hashem made, men and women. But if they are compared to her like monkeys, try to imagine her beauty. Now what can you ask more than that? An 18 years old guy, in the years that the man has the strongest desire, this is when he grow up, he goes into this woman and she seduced him from morning to night. Every second she changes her clothes. She's changing her outfits, beautiful handmade outfits, silk, this, perfumes, doing her hair, all day begging him to have relation with her. Think about it. And he doesn't want to touch her. The Torah says, why Yosef didn't want to touch her? No, what's the problem? Once he would make a scene with her, then ask Hashem to forgive him. What's the answer? Do you know what's the answer? Because he knew that if a Jew have relation with a goy, in the next world he can never get rid of this embarrassment for eternity. לא רצה לשכב אצלה בעולם הזה, כאילו שלא תהיה קשורה בו ככלב. The Gemara gives an example like a person that has a dog on the street. You know these dogs that they attach to you everywhere you go, you try to get rid of him, but he doesn't give up. And you go crazy. You try to meet your doctor now, he comes in. You go to bed, he jumps on the bed. You go now to the supermarket, he comes after you. You have a ceremony, your son get married, he stand next to you in a chuppah. Think about the embarrassment. You die. Say, oh God, take me out of this world already. This dog doesn't want to go. And smelling is rotten in everything. This is a parable. And if I would make the scene with her, she's tied to me like the dog doesn't leave a person. She's tied to me. That's it. I cannot get rid of her. He was running to the mountains over there, sticking his finger in the ground. This is an opinion. This is when a person has strong desire and he cannot hold himself, he has to take his finger, put it strongly in the mouth, or press very strong on his ears or on his toes. Secrets from Kabbalah. Not to let sperms come out of his body if he has very strong desire. But a smart person never let himself get to a situation like this. Because that's it. Yaakov Avinu, Jacob, first drop of seed that came out of his body when he was 86 years old. It's true, the world was different than today. People live much longer life. But still, 86 years, first drop of seed is his son Reuven. How do we know? The Torah says, Reuven, you are the first drop of seed came out of my body. Reuven is oldest son. That's what the Torah says. The Torah, God is not a liar. He wrote it in his Torah. 86 years, he never made a sin. Think about it. 86 years. I tell you a story. One time I got a phone call somewhere in California. A man is calling me. And this is in our generation. This is about 2-3 years ago. Everything I'm telling you now, it's 100% as it was. No adding, no the whole story. I just don't tell you from what state and what's the name of the person. But everything else, I tell you right up front. He calls me up. He says, I watched your lecture about peace between husband and wife. Relationship. And I'm just very scared now. I say to him, why? What happened? He said, I just realized that I'm making a lot of mistakes with my wife. I said, okay, you can still correct your mistake. Now at least you know what's wrong. He said, no, but it bothers me very much. So I said to him, oh, tell me, be more specific. What's the problem? He said, listen, I don't know if I have to give the respect to my wife because my wife, it's a very unique situation with me. I said, what do you mean? He said, from the moment I married my wife, I had relation with her one time, and for more than 20 years, she doesn't let me touch her. 20 years. She doesn't let me touch her. No, absolutely not. So I say to him, what kind of marriage is this? How are you still with her? I was very surprised. So he say, yeah, you know, I think they adopted, they have kids, but not from personal relation, from in a transplant. Transplant by the doctor, like barren people. That's how they had kids. She doesn't, yeah, did you ever hear such a story in history? So I say to him, I don't understand, it's a sin. She's probably making you, who knows how many sins you make. You live with a woman in the same house, in a room. She comes out of the shower, you see her, and she doesn't let you touch her. What is this? Of course. He said to me, no. Baruch Hashem, thank God, I never made a sin. Baruch Hashem, I'm very careful with that. So I say to him, you sure you never made a sin? And I see the person is honest. He's very, very big tzaddik. The way he thinks about things, how he's very careful with his sins. He said, yeah, yeah, I'm very careful. I understand how important it is not to waste seed, he says. I never made a sin, Baruch Hashem. More than 20 years, he lived with a woman in a house and he never made one time a sin. I say to him, you calling me for advice and tell me to give you bracha and all this, I have to run to kiss your hands. You have to give me a blessing. What is this? I don't think there's another person in the whole world, tzaddik, like you. The hardest thing in life like this, and you hold yourself for so many years. So right away I thought about Yaakov Avinu and Yosef. This is the Yaakov Avinu of this generation. Can you believe such a thing? This is what we have to learn from real heroes. Ezu Agibor, what the Torah says. Who is a real hero? Someone who built his muscles, walking on the beach like this with his shirt cut, you know, looking around, who is paying attention to the oil that he puts on his muscle, like this. If nobody gave him a compliment, he gets angry. Hey, you, I'm talking to you. Why? He wants him to pay attention, or to her, I should say. Sometimes it's to him, depends. You know? So what's going on here? 20 years he suffered in a gym to attract some attention. Not talking this kind of thing. This is not a hero. This is a sick man. A sick man, what do you think? It's a mental case. Person willing to suffer in a gym for so many years, taking steroids, how do you call it? Steroids, right? Not asteroids, steroids. Steroids, just to pump his body like this, maybe he'll get a compliment. You know? The Torah says, no, that's not, that's a balloon. That's not a hero. Who is a hero? Someone who can win against his evil inclination. Try one time to have delicious food on the table and not to touch. Try one time, see how hard it is. Try one time, like you get a compliment and you're about to make a scene with a guy or with a girl, but not to do it. Try one time when you come to a lecture and every 2 minutes somebody walks through the door, not to look at the door. Not to look, just to focus on the shiur. 1 hour, 50 times people opened the door and came here, and one time you didn't see. Try one time, you see. You can't. You're getting beaten and butchered by the evil inclination, one after the other. Try. That's a hero. The Torah is teaching you discipline. No other way in the world you can learn such discipline. Rak the Torah, only the Torah. The best psychology, it's the best therapy, it's the best advice, it's the blessing, it's modesty, it's holiness, it's everything, it's happiness, everything. So Hashem say, no, you're not getting punished because you didn't keep. Yes, you kept, but with a very sour face, if the kids see that their parents go to shul, but they're upset, 7 o'clock, I'm tired, it's hard. Can they change it to 9 o'clock? Why 7 o'clock? So the boy think, wow, religion is suffering. Look at my father. Why do I need this? Nachon olo, that's it. Oh, yeah. Complain about that. Somebody comes to him to ask for charity. Can you help the yeshiva? Oof, again, these rabbis, all the time they need things. Okay, hold on here. And in the kitchen here, 18 cents. You know, it reminds me, one guy came to collect donation in one shul. I don't want to tell you where it was. You figure it out yourself. So he came to the shul, and he said to the rabbi, I have to collect, and this and that. So the rabbi said, the rabbi smiled. So, okay, go ahead. So the guy didn't understand how he was so generous. Usually, who are you? Why? Why you want to collect? Show me Teuda from Sha'aret Zion. They have to go get registered by the Syrian. Sha'aret Zion, they pay $100 application fee that the Syrian approve you, that you really have things. They make some phone calls to ask if you're not a crook. Then sometimes you don't even get the $100 in the 1 day you spend. You don't cover for the certificate. That's besides the point. Anyway, so he comes, the rabbi says, okay, go ahead. So he says, Rabotai, we're making a collection for this rabbi, for this gentleman. Please. No? So one guy say, hi. No? Good start, hi. Then another one say, 26. Then another one say 30. And another one say 36. So, you know, this rabbi say, $36. No, better than nothing. I'm only a minute here. Then one guy say 52. So, oh, it's getting better. One guy say 72. One guy say, make it a holy number, 77. Ooh, mitkadmim. Then one guy said, 77, 90. One guy say, 95. So, wow, they slowly but surely. Then one guy scream, $1. He was sure that it's $1. He said to the rabbi, now I understand why you say you're welcome. You already know who you're dealing with. The guy said, thank you very much. Goodbye. So it says like this, and I finish with that, and if you have questions, you can ask. It says like this. ואתה עמך נמצאו פה, ראיתי בשמחה להתנדב לך. השם אלוקי אברהם, יצחק וישראל אבותינו, שומרה זאת לעולם, ליצר מחשבות לבב עמך, ואכן לבבם אליך. When King David saw the nation of Israel volunteering money, donating money, not 99 cents, dollar, lots of money to build the temple, we're collecting money to build Bet HaMikdash. He saw that everyone is so happy to give money, they're so happy, and they're not doing it because their name is going to be on the building like today. Rabbi, how big is the name? Me and my wife will be on the front of the building. The bigger it is, the more zeros you're going to have on the check. You want to make it small? Only 1,000. You make it a little bigger, I'll add zero, 10,000. A huge few places? 100,000. You call the whole building on my name? 1,000,000. What do you see? He cares about the building. He cares about his ego. Why does he care? If he wouldn't be embarrassed, if the church will give him the honor, he will do it. Why does he care? So, it says like this. When King David saw how everyone fighting, who's going to give more, running to give money, they're so happy that finally they built the first temple. This is 300 years after they entered the land of Israel. 300 years they waited. They enter, only 300 years, King David preparing the foundation of the temple, and his son King Solomon built it. He started to pray to Hashem, שתתקיים עמידה טובה בהם ולא תסור. Please God, I'm begging you, keep them always like this. And this is what he says, I saw how they're happy to volunteer and contribute to you. The God of Abraham, Isaac and Israel, our father, שומרה זאת לעולם, keep it for the descendants of Israel for eternity. ליצר מחשבות לבב עמך ואכן לבבם. Make sure to dedicate their heart that will stay like this forever to you. Did Hashem hear his prayer? I'm not sure. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. We see some Jews are like this, some not. Today, if the religious world will get 1% of the amount of the donations that Jews that die leave to the United Negro Fund, or to hospitals, or to museums, or to colleges, or to reform shuls, places that do not contribute anything to the soul of the donor, nothing whatsoever, doesn't give him one mitzvah, not one little tiny credit, 99.9% of the cases will bring him a serious punishment when God will show him what happened with his money. But I'm not even talking about the punishment. For sure, no reward for giving it to the, sometimes to the enemies of Israel, or sometimes to all kinds of museums who show naked ladies and statues and idol worshiping and who knows what. It's not a mitzvah. And now you may ask me, but what's the problem? They give it to the hospital. Okay, they don't give it to yeshiva, but they give it to hospital. Depend. Most hospitals, 50% of their patients are the haters of Israel and God. Who are they? Pakistanis from Al-Qaeda, Palestinians that donate to the Hamas,
or to the other kind, the Hezbollah, or German Nazis, or American Nazis, the KKK. They don't go to hospitals. When you donate to one New York hospital, you have a million patients a year in this place. At least half a million of them either hate Jews, or hate the Torah, or hate religious people, or hurt Jews, hurt terrorists, contributing to terrorists, putting all kinds of anti-Semite remarks on the internet. You donate, the Jew donate to the hospital, nobody, of course, say thank you to him. And the hospital take care of all these murderers and anti-Semites, that they will be stronger, that they can defeat Israel even more. So how do you want to get reward? Yeah, maybe you meant well. You wanted to help sick people, but you never thought, because you don't have Torah. You didn't ask your rabbi what to do. You want to donate hospital? Donate to Hadassah and Karim in Israel, or to Bikur Cholim, not Hadassah, Bikur Cholim. Every public hospitals, they must accept every patient. Even the son of Hitler come, they have to take care of him. Hitler himself would come to hospital, they must take care of him. They have to. There's nothing they can do. Arafat come to the hospital, they have to take care of him. Even they hate him, they have to take care of him. You understand? There's nothing they can do. That's the law. If not, they shut him up. So your money went to this massive murderer to save his life. What do you think? Where do they get all the power? Where do you think Iran has all their technology from? Do you know? Everything from Israel. Just 3 days ago, they say on the news, all the highest advanced Iranian technology that make them defeated United States and take that plane, the spying plane. They have a plane with remote. They just caught it 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Drone.
What's the name of it?
Drone.
What, it's special, it's take pictures and they with remote control, they can send it anywhere. It's an amazing thing, they caught it now. And now they get all the technology and they want to sell it to China and Russia, it's a disaster. It's a very serious problem. They just found out in Israel, he sold it to them. All the equipment, through Denmark. They cannot sell directly to Iran because there's embargo. So he pretend he's dumb. He sold it to somebody in Denmark who sold it to Iran. Just a few months ago, the biggest chemical company in the world that owned by a Jew, I don't want to tell you his name, Holocaust survivor, sell all the ammonia to Iran. They put it on the television. Holocaust survivor Jew, his company sell to Iran. Not directly, of course. They sell it to Europe and they ship it to Iran. How do you think they have an atomic bomb soon? You understand? Jews helping the enemies to destroy Israel. And this is what Hashem warned us in the Torah. Ma'arsayich u'machrivayich memech yetzu. The destroyers of the nation of Israel will be from among them. The goyim cannot touch you, nothing. Everything the Jews do to themselves. Greed, lack of unity, nobody cares, no mitzvot, no Torah, no irat shamayim. God gives him $100 million, he gives it to places. You know what? Let's conclude like this. Let's say he gave it to a really good cause, but nothing to do with Torah and this. It's still stupid. Why? Okay, so you did a few favors to people, widows, orphans, sick people, everything fine. Didn't you know that supporting Torah or saving souls is a billion times greater? Why you invest in a stock who bring 5% a year when you can get 5,000,000% a year with the same money? Why? 5% is good, I'm happy. Give me 5%, I'm happy. But 5,000,000% is better than 5%. So why to leave it over there? Leave it in Torah, in Irat Shamayim. Leave it to the kids who cannot afford to go to yeshiva and they ended up in public school and they married the goyim because of that. How do you think all the Jewish girls meet the goyim? 99% of intermarriage come because of public school. If all Jews would go to serious yeshivot, you still have some intermarriage. You cannot avoid it 100%. But the Jews would understand that we have no permission. They will get the right education and they would not go to even open an opportunity that a goy will touch them or marry them. But right now, they grew up together, 12 years in the same class, eating together, laughing together, exchanging homeworks, and they're not religious. And they say, wow, you're racist. Why you talk like this?
I love my boyfriend Chris. Why are you racist? It's nothing about me. I didn't write the Torah. What do you want from me? What, I'm the writer of the Torah? If I was the writer of the Torah, call me racist, you're right. But the creator of all mankind wrote, and the Goyim cannot deny it. They say the Torah is true. What are they saying? The Torah say to the Jews, you have no permission. Even the most wicked Jew in history is not allowed to marry the most righteous Gentile in history. Take Eov, the prophet of the Goyim, and take Isabel, the worst Jew probably ever lived, woman, they cannot get married. Nothing to do with good person or not. Can be the best Goy, can be the best Goya, can be lover of God, can pray to God, can give donation to Jewish causes, can kiss mezuzah, even whatever you want, eat kosher, not allowed to marry them. We have no permission. God didn't give us permission. And that's what happened. Instead of these Jews leaving the money to Jewish causes to send kids to yeshiva, you know how many parents dying to send their kids to yeshiva and they can't afford? It's not cheap. Yeshivot, it's a private school. Non-Jewish private school costs double than yeshivot. In Great Neck, there is a private school, more than 20,000 tuition for every little kid. In yeshivot, it's much cheaper. But still, some parents have 4, 5, 6, 7 kids, cannot pay it. Not everyone is a millionaire. And the kids ended up in public school, and they age 18, they don't know how to say Shema Israel. They don't know how to read Hebrew. They don't know anything about Judaism, nothing. Just my wife on my way here, she told me, on my way here I spoke to her, that she got from the library a film that Eish HaTorah made, Eish.com. Maybe you probably saw this film or you will see it. Eish made a film. What is it? The Jewish identity. They stand on a street, I think, in Manhattan, and they interview many people. Before they start to film, they ask the people on the street, excuse me, are you Jewish? And those who say yes, they ask them a few questions. They ask all the Jews on the street of Manhattan, if you had the chance to learn more about your Jewish identity, would you give it a chance? Not even one say no. Everyone says, of course, absolutely. I actually want to learn more Judaism. Everyone. They're thirsty, but nobody knows where to start. One of them say, I really want. I am a believer, but I don't go to synagogue. So they told him, why? I say, my wife is Christian. How would I play myself a Jew? I already, you know, in front of the camera. And each one of them. And then they ask religious Jews on the street, Hasidim, Litvish, all kinds of religious people. Do you think Kiruv is important? I didn't see the film yet. I'm just telling you from what she told me. You have to see it. From the way she described it, it's a very influential movie. So they asked the religious Jews in Borough Park, in places, do you think it's important to bring Jews back to the Torah to show them the truth? Of course, it's very important. Do you do it? No, I can't. Why? I'm afraid it will influence my children. That they will bring my children down when they see this kind of people. They have no religion, no faith. How will I bring them to my home? So one of them say, I'm not doing it, my son doing it. But I really worry about him, that he's going to go down because of it. Everyone is afraid to do it. Everyone is afraid to do it. Yeah, there are some casualties. They have a point. But it's just to show you that the religious side really want, but they're afraid. And the other side is very thirsty for Judaism. Such a shame. The owner of the business is dying to sell, and the customer is dying to buy, and there's no one to put them together. Such a shame. If all of them say, nah, leave me alone, Judaism, it's not for me. I'm happy the way I am. No, what can you do? But almost everyone, they show you, one after the other, of course, I would love to. But there's nobody to do it. They don't have anything. Okay, we're done for today. Any questions before we finished? Any questions?
I was in Canada.
Huh?
I was in Canada.
Canada was amazing. You came a little late. I said in the beginning, it was very good. One lecture after the other, more than 300 people, fantastic atmosphere, mamash very good. And besides, in general, the atmosphere in Canada, from what I've seen, the people are more calm, more relaxed, more polite. It's different than New York. Everything is under stress, is that. More, you know, like you can see everything is relaxed, quiet. The Jews and the Goyim. Even the goyim in the hotel, yeah, you can't believe how polite they are, how they serve. Everything nice. You need coffee. Run to get you. What does he owe you? So I'm sorry, I don't know where it is. He ran. No, no, hold on 1 second. Let me go look for you. Today in the morning, I came to the kitchen. Everyone left already last night. We prayed Rosh Chodesh today. We pray Shachrit in the morning. And right away, I got on my way after the tefillah. So in the morning, I need, hardly slept there. I need a big, giant cup of coffee. So I had, I bring my own Turkish coffee. One cup of that is like 10 American coffee, you know. So I bring it. Now I need sugar and I need you know, hot water. No, come to the kitchen. Help you here. Bring, where is the sugar? No, no problem. Let me look for you. He runs around 5 minutes. He looks for the sugar. He brings the sugar. I say, but how will I mix? No problem. Hold on. Let me see. Run. Mamash, different world. Imagine the world would be like this everywhere. That everyone is nice to each other. All the elevator, this, all the doors. Thank you, good night, hope you enjoy. Different world. Everything will be better. That's Canada.
Then New York wouldn't be like a New York.
Big deal, it wouldn't be. Yeah. It wouldn't be. It's not a bargain. Not a bargain. Be'ezrat Hashem, we all be in Israel. When Mashiach come and all the problems will be over. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.